Hello and welcome to Queersay. I'm Andrew Kay and my guest today is Michael Hynes.
Hello.
Thank you for coming in.
It's an absolute pleasure. Thank you for asking me. It's
always a pleasure having you here, Michael, and listening to your views, which are so erudite. Are you keeping well?
I'm very well, thank you.
Good, good. I thought we'd start by doing a little bit of an announcement. This is a shout out to the people of Brighton and Hove, and not just the gay community here, but to everybody, because Billy, the lovely Billy Lewis, is mounting a charity dinner in support of the Brighton and Hove LGBT plus community safety forum. Mm-hmm. And that's taking place on the 12th of October, I believe. Mm. Is that right?
Yes, and they do some amazing work in the community.
Incredible.
So really well worth supporting. And it's going to be an absolutely fabulous night.
Well, it's an evening of cabaret with some of the best performers from Brighton and Hove's cabaret scene, mm-hmm. so I'm hoping that all my favourites will be there.
Yep.
It's £29 for a ticket, mm-hmm. And that includes your three-course dinner.
Yeah.
So that's not bad. I mean, you can spend £29 on a bag of chips these days, can't you? Yep. It's not too bad. Let's see if I can find out exactly where you can buy your tickets from. There is a phone number. It's 01273 725 331. But we'll try and get that information on the screen as well so that people can. But please do support this. It's really, really very, very worthwhile. I would support Billy in almost anything because he is such a dedicated person to our community and does so much good work.
Yes.
Not everyone does the same amount of good work, I have to say. And much as I like Tom Ford and what he's done, and particularly his perfumes, which are glorious. Sometimes I think he says things that are a little bit bizarre. And our first story is that Tom Ford has come out in the press in America and said, "You're a man sleeping with men. That doesn't mean you're gay."
Mm.
What do you think?
I think there's two sides to this. On the one hand, I think that it can be an excuse for some people to support their own homophobia. So there are men who say, well, I sleep with men, but that doesn't mean I'm gay, because they have a lot of internalized homophobia, and that then reinforces that. So there is a negative side. But on the other side, I really like the idea of a world where we don't have to identify.
Me too.
Or where I could identify as a gay man and perhaps fall in love with a woman for a time and not define myself by that, but define myself as a gay man.
I mean, many years ago, Tom Robinson did exactly that. Mm. He still defines himself as a gay man, mm-hmm. but he is married with children, and he very much loves his wife.
Yeah.
And I thought it was miraculous that he did that at the time. It was an extraordinary thing to do because he was very much in the public eye as a pop star.
Yes.
And then became a very seriously good broadcaster.
Yeah.
And I agree completely. I think we should all reserve the right to change our mind.
Oh, yes.
I mean, being able to change your mind is surely one of the basic human rights.
Yeah.
And if you didn't have the right to change your mind, then that would mean that all the people who are homophobes would have the right to not have their minds changed.
Yeah.
And we don't want that.
Yeah. And being gay simply is my own definition of my own sexuality. Mm-hmm. It doesn't define my character. It doesn't define my personality. It simply defines my own, the way that I see my own sexuality. That's it.
That's about the end of it, isn't it? He's marvellous, though. I mean, he's just released a new perfume. I think we've got to talk about this. He's very much about... I mean, I wear Tom Ford fragrances because I think they're wonderful, and they are not male or female, anyone can wear them. And he says, why can't a man wear a beautiful peony-based fragrance? Mm-hmm. And his new fragrance, which is peony-based, has got the most amazing name. And I'm going to risk saying this, but his new fragrance is called... I mean, it's very bold, isn't it?
It's certainly different.
I mean, you can imagine going into Boots and saying, can I have a bottle of... Other chemists are available. I think he's extraordinary. These clothes are out there. But as a director, he made the most beautiful film about a man coming to terms with dying and his sexuality called A Single Man. A beautiful, beautiful film. And I'm sure he's going to go on to do lots of really exciting things in the future. And I think we really do need to support people, even when they come out and say fairly racy things. We call them racy. But I think he's a real character, and more to him. The other thing that he said in this article was that he made a very bold statement that all men, no matter what their sexuality, should be penetrated at least once. And I think you and I have agreed that maybe that is just for an inspection for prostate cancer. And we would encourage everyone who thinks they might have a prostate problem to go and be penetrated for medical reasons alone.
Yeah, I'm just leaving that one there.
Let's not go there, shall we?
I'm not going any further there. Yeah, no.
Our second story today is that more than 1,000 schools are launching projects to stamp out homophobic bullying. And it's part of a £3 million initiative led by the government's Equalities Office. Mm-hmm. This is really good news.
It is. I'm just really hoping that what they do is that they ally themselves to LGBT organisations so that they get the correct information out there and they approach this in a way that's really beneficial and helps people. It can be very easy to launch a programme like this and then think that a whole group of people who really don't know what it is to be LGBT can put the programme together. Really, we've got some amazing people in the community, some amazing groups like Stonewall, for example, who put together extraordinary programmes. Yeah. I just hope that they're aligning with those so that we get the correct information out there.
Well, I am meeting with people in Brighton today from all sorts.
Of course.
And yes. I would absolutely hope that they have been involved in this, because really, I mean, if the government think they can do this on their own, then they're just really silly. Yeah. There are, as you say, lots of people out there who've been doing this and doing a brilliant job for a long, long time.
Yeah.
You know, but I do sense sometimes that the government go off on their own little track and don't ask people's opinions. Yeah. I hope they have on this one. But it is good news, and it's good news that they're actually acknowledging the fact that there is a massive problem and one that has to be dealt with, because it's not going away, is it?
No, in fact, it's been getting worse recently. So, yeah.
I think it's getting much worse. And I think there's an awful lot of kids out there who use terminology, which is colloquial slang for things being bad, using the word gay to mean bad, because being gay is synonymous with bad, and we need to rid our language of that straight away. That is terrible. I just hope that this £3 million is enough. Because although £3 million sounds like a lot of money, when you spread that across 1,000 schools, it's not an awful lot of cash, is it?
No.
You know, I can't do the sums.
No, but it's not every school either, so...
Well, no, how do they decide which schools need it and which schools don't?
Yeah.
Maybe they're not doing public schools because it's part of the curriculum, homosexuality in boarding schools.
I wouldn't know, that wasn't mine.
No, well, I wasn't, but I did meet a lot of boys who were, and it seemed that it was part of the curriculum for quite a lot of them. It was a bit racy, wasn't it? Let's not go there, shall we? I love this. A new artificial intelligence programme says that it can 91% accurately tell if you're gay based on your face alone. So I'm looking at you. Now, you're not artificially intelligent. You're very intelligent.
Yeah.
Could you tell just by looking at me if I was gay or not?
I think it's context.
I think the tie might give it away.
The fact that we're sat here on Queersay talking about these things kind of gives it away. But one of the things that I noticed was that the faces that they used were from dating apps. So if you're a gay man on a dating app, you're going to look...
You're going to try and look like the part, aren't you?
The part.
Yeah.
And even then, it wasn't 100% successful. No. I mean, it still was something like 80%. And I do think that there is a challenge there in that what you don't want is people thinking that that there are certain traits that identify somebody as LGBT and somebody who's not. And we're going to be talking about the situation with King in Kuwait at some point. And again, we live in a society where you can very easily be marked negatively for being LGBT.
Absolutely.
So you don't want anything that
I think you're absolutely right about bringing up the fact that they only chose faces from dating apps. Yeah. And of course, and we've talked about this before, about tribalism within the gay community, that we all try and belong to certain factions. You know, so the Burrs, back in the 70s and 80s, the clones, you know, the twinks. There are these looks that people have, you know. I mean, show me a gay man these days without a beard. Not many. Only the ones who can't quite grow one yet. But, you know, we like to come from, we like to be a part of a group, so we are identifiable. So really, it's not that brilliant. Why would you spend all that money developing artificial intelligence that could actually decide from your face? It was a waste of money. Why did they need to do that?
Now, the only good thing that I can see is that if that is the case, that there are certain modes that are identifiable, then it also means that that those who are LGBT, it reinforces the argument that being LGBT is not a choice, that actually it's part of who we are. Because if it's identifiable from birth, then it is integral to who we are as people. So that's the positive side, I suppose.
I think it's a very positive side, and we're going to go to a break now. We'll come back in a moment. We're going to talk about football. Hello and welcome back to Queersay. I'm Andrew Kay. My guest today is Michael Hynes. I'm still giggling about the idea of software to tell whether you're gay or not. I can't believe that anyone would just waste that amount of money when you could just go up to someone and bravely say, hello, are you gay? Didn't want to offend you, but I would hate to make an approach to you if you're not. But, you know, ridiculous.
Yeah.
Waste of money. Do something important. And something important really is actually ridding football of homophobia, and it is re-emerging at the moment. We've had an incident, someone being prosecuted at a match with the Seagulls, mm-hmm. where there was homophobic chanting. Mm-hmm. But this is the National Football League star, Aaron Rodgers, and he's saying that gay players are still losing their jobs. Mm-hmm. It's extraordinary, this thing with sport, the feeling that you can only be a sportsman if you're actively butch and heterosexual. You know, there's this weird assumption.
Yeah, I would take the actively butch out of there, because there are lots of actively butch homosexual men.
Well, that's not what I mean, but everything within sport. I mean, that's exactly my point, Michael. You know, within the gay community, I mean, these days, butch is big again.
Yeah, well, I couldn't read this without thinking about Sophie Cook. And I know Sophie Cook is the official photographer for Bournemouth FC.
Well, she's actually left now.
Has she? Okay,
she's actually left now, but she was for a long time.
Yes, and I remember she came to our church and told her coming out story and how she went there after she'd chosen to identify as Sophie. And one, the manager said, what can we do to make this easier for you? And secondly, when the manager introduced Sophie to the football group during a training session, they just applauded her. Mm-hmm. And it's proof that this kind of stuff needs to come from the top down, not from the not from the players up. It needs to come from the management down.
Yeah.
And it needs to be the management that says, this is the way that we will treat you if you come out as LGBT. This is what we will do. This is our stand. And if anybody disagrees with that, then we have a problem with them. And it really does need to start at the top. So shame on those groups that don't make a stand and don't step out. And I really do applaud those that do, that actually sort out those folks who are making homophobic chants and take them out and say, right, you know, let's sort this out. We've got a problem here.
I was very shocked to learn that of all the Premier League teams, Brighton and Hove is one of the few that doesn't have an LGBT supporters group.
Really?
Which in our city I would have thought would be immediate, wouldn't you?
Except that there are probably so many LGBT supporters. It's not like we're in the...
Oh, you reckon they're all of them?
Well, no, but I think that it's... I think where LGBT supporters are such a minority, then it's really important to be visible. Whereas in Brighton, I don't think you would have a problem or an issue. Certainly not the Bournemouth FC, not the the Brighton FC supporters that I know, both LGBT and straight. They would never have a problem with people being LGBT either.
But I think maybe it's important to actually affirm a voice. I think that could be worth doing.
Yeah.
And
oh,
I'm
yeah.
surprised that I'm surprised that they don't have them. But this is it's worrying that this is still going on. And you're absolutely right. It has to come from the top down. And at the same time, I believe it has to come up from the terraces too.
Yes.
I think it has to come up the other way. Our next story is a bit of a bad news story, I'm afraid. And this is that LGBT hate crime in the UK is up by nearly 80% since 2013. What is going wrong here? Because we're living in a more open society. We're able to have marriages and civil partnerships. The presence of openly gay people in the media has never been better. We have gay stars on our TV screens the whole time, and some even in the cinema from Hollywood. And yet, hate crime has gone up. Why?
I don't have an answer for the whole thing, because if you look at, it's not just the UK, if you look at America and Trump, then you look at the recent ban on the transgender folks serving in the armed forces, you look at the way that Mexican nationals are being treated in America now. I think that it is a global issue. But here in the UK, perhaps some of it was started during the Brexit process, I think, because a lot of the rhetoric that I heard throughout the Brexit process, especially on social media, was coming from people who are very bigoted.
Yeah.
Now, and on both sides. And I think that when we voted to leave the European Union, those people who'd used a very bigoted ticket in order to promote that saw that, and they are in a minority, I have to say, and it's people who voted for and against. It's not one group, but it just happens to be that those who voted for and did so on a bigoted ticket then felt empowered to be able to publicly display their
bigotry.
We
gave them a voice. The opportunity gave them a voice.
Yeah, and it's going to take us... it's going to take another very public voice from the public as well as the government to be able to bring that down again, because it can't happen.
Stonewall have issued some initiatives here, and I think it's quite good to go through these. Their first one is to take a stand against LGBT hate crime by joining Stonewall's Come Out for LGBT campaign, and encourage all your friends to do that. And you can do that at stonewall.org.uk, Come Out for LGBT. Call an out online anti-abuse as long as it's safe to do so, and be an ally to those being targeted. In other words, if you see it happening, don't walk away, do something about it. If you see this in a local business, tell the owners, if the staff or the customers are involved in any sort of anti-LGBT incident, so they can tackle it. I mean, again, don't walk away from it, don't shy away from it. And finally, report any incidents of homophobic, biphobic or transphobic discrimination when accessing public services like housing or social services. And tell the service provider and the council. So Stonewall's own information service is on 08000 502020, and they will advise anyone who needs any help on that. Yeah. We've come a long way, they say, in the last 25 years, but there's a huge amount of work to do. It would only take one homophobic hate crime a year for me to believe that there's still a lot of work to do.
And I think, especially here in Brighton, we need to ensure that hate crime is being reported. And there is a reported app that you can get for your phone. You can talk to the LGBT safety community safety forum, and you can do so anonymously, so that if you're afraid of any kind of repercussion, then at least your voice can still be heard, and the incident can be counted. And I think that's really important, that we ensure that each and every incident is recorded, so that we have a really good idea of what's going on, so that we can address it appropriately.
Absolutely. So please, if you are involved in any kind of hate crime as the victim, then don't shy away. Stand up and be counted, because it's only by doing that we will actually get something done about this. Make it public. Our final story in this episode is about an Instagram star who was arrested and abused in the Kuwait jail for looking too feminine. It is, again, about safety, isn't it? And it's about knowing, I think this is about knowing how to behave in certain circumstances. If you think you might be in a place where you are vulnerable for whatever reason, it's not right that you have to hide, and it's not right that you should behave in a different way, but if you want to be safe, you have to pay attention to where you are.
Yeah, and again, I think that you're right. There are two sides to this. On the one hand, you have to be careful, but on the other hand, there are some places where being careful is never enough. Mm. So, for example, a couple of weeks ago, there were two trans women who were sentenced to a year in jail each in the United Arab Emirates simply for being for presenting as women.
Yes.
Because they saw them as men dressed in women's clothing and not as trans women. So that they're put in jail for a year. That's absolutely outrageous. And the United Arab Emirates should be absolutely ashamed of doing that. But also, we should be very cautious about who we do business with. And in Kuwait, for example, Kuwait has a small population, something like 4.8 million. Mm. Only about a million of them are national Kuwaitis. It has a 75% rate of expats who come from neighboring countries. Who,
yes.
You know, so it's I think that there's more to do than just being aware of that when we go to those countries. It's also being aware of who we do business with and how we do business and how we support that.
I think that's a very important point, Michael, and I think we need to really, really emphasise to everybody that if you see these things going on globally, pull away from it.
Yeah.
Don't support it. I think it's really sad that there are places in the world that I don't feel I want to go to because of this. I'd love to go and see the pyramids, but I'm not going to go to Egypt until they sort out their attitude to LGBT issues.
Of course.
But for now, unfortunately, that's all we've got time for. Thank you for watching Queersay. Thank you for coming in and joining me, Michael. I see you for the next episode, I believe.
It's always a pleasure. Thank you.
See you very soon.